Welcome to the 8th unit of the course on Bayesian probability theory. My name is Wolfgang von der Linden, and I will enable you to help Captain Bayes and her crew to deal with continuous variables and to learn how to assign prior probabilities. We will learn how to work with probability densities instead of probability mass functions. We will learn how to use the transformation law to locate the lighthouse. The principle of transformation invariance will allow us to derive Jeffrey's prior, and we will study the probability distribution of the first digits of mathematical tables. Up to this point, we have actually only introduced the rules of probability theory for discrete variables. But you certainly realized that continuous variables have also crept into the problems of the last unit, like in the star path problem or the fishing ground problem. We even mentioned probability densities. The values of parameters in the continuous case can take on any real number in a given interval or even on the entire real axis. Now it's time to extend the rules of probability theory to continuous variables. Let's start with the following consideration. Assume we are interested in the height of trees. Typically, it ranges between zero and a maximum height. To get started, we discretize the possible heights into n intervals of equal length. For simplicity, we assume that all heights are equally probable. Therefore, the probability that the height of a randomly selected tree lies in a certain interval is the same for all intervals. Two things are important to note here. If we increase the number of intervals, the probability goes to zero. So the probability for a continuous variable to have a precise value is zero, and hence it makes no sense to speak of probabilities or to use a probability mass function to assign probabilities to certain variables. We see that the probability is proportional to the interval size delta L. Both points stay valid in the case of non-equidistant intervals and also if the height distribution of trees is not uniform. In general, we find for the probability that the height of a tree lies in a certain interval is proportional to the length of this interval. The proportionality function is the probability density. It is the probability to find a tree with length in the interval from L to L plus delta L divided by the interval length. The probability for the height of a tree to fall into an interval can also be obtained from the difference of the probability that the height of the tree is less than L plus delta L minus the probability that the height of the tree is less than L. We introduce a special symbol for these probabilities, which are called cumulative distribution functions. The reason for this term will become clear when we rewrite equation star in terms of the CDF. For infinitesimal interval lengths, the PDF turns into the derivative of the CDF, and in turn the CDF is the integral of the PDF. That explains why it is called cumulative. We also see that the normalization implies that the CDF approaches 1 when the length approaches the upper limit of the range of this random variable. To keep the notation clear, we denote PDFs with the lowercase letter p and stick with the uppercase letter p for the probability mass functions. The sum and the product rule are the same for continuous and discrete variables. But the normalization and the marginalization rule are slightly different, as we do have integrals instead of sums. Here the difference between the four marginalization formulas is that capital letters stand for discrete and lowercase letters for continuous variables. Similarly, the mean value of functions f of x of continuous random variables x are also converted to integrals. Here the probability mass function is replaced by the PDF. Now there is a specialty of continuous variables. You can introduce transformations like you map L to M of L equal to L to the power 3, which for a spherical tree would be proportional to the mass, and if one is interested in the mass, then the corresponding PDF would be P of M. Then a question occurs naturally. If we know the PDF P of L for the length, what is the PDF P of M for the mass? The probability that the height of a tree lies in the interval L to L plus DL is given by DP. The mass of these trees lies in the interval M up to M plus DM. Since they are the same trees, we can express DP in terms of the mass. And finally, due to the unique relation M is a function of L and L is a unique function of M, we obtain the very important transformation law. For the case of the uniform height distribution from above, P of L is constant, we obtain the PDF for the mass. So instead of being uniform, the PDF for the mass is sharply peaked at zero. That brings us to a very fundamental question. How do we describe ignorant PDFs? In the discrete case, the law of indifference implied equal probability. But in the case of continuous variables, ignorance does not necessarily imply a uniform PDF. As a further example, let us consider a non-negative quantity x that is known to have a uniform PDF in the interval 0 to x max. But we are interested in the PDF of a variable y that shall be the exponential of x. The desired PDF is proportional to 1 over y. So we have found if a variable is linear on a logarithmic scale, then it has a 1 over y dependence on the linear scale. Finally, we want to consider the transformation law for the multivariate case. Let x be a set of variables with n elements and y a new set of variables with the invertible transformations y is a unique function of x and x in turn is a unique function of y. Then the PDFs are related by the following expression, where the last factor is the Jacobi determinant. The crew of Captain Bass was pondering about the so-called Bertrand paradox, which is defined as follows. Given a circle of radius r and a random set of lines that cross the circle, what is the probability that a random line has a distance from the center that is less than half the radius? The line cuts the circle at two points, P1 and P2. We can define these endpoints by the angles Φ1 and Φ2 formed by the radial lines to the endpoints with the x-axis. These are two independent variables that uniquely define the line. The line is also uniquely defined by the midpoint P of the two endpoints P1 and P2. I guess it's needless to explain why. This involves again two independent variables, namely the x and y coordinate of the point. Finally, for solving the problem, it is enough to know the distance r of the line from the center of the circle. Now think of how you would simulate the problem on the computer. Bernoulli came up with the idea to choose the points P1 and P2 at random on the circle. That is equivalent to choosing the two angles Φ1 and Φ2 at random. That in turn implies that the PDF of the intermediate angle is uniform. In this variable, the distance of the line to the center is given by r times the cosine of phi half. And the condition that the line has a distance less than r half from the center is given by. Hence, the desired probability is 1/3. Another way of generating the line at random was proposed in the adventure by Pascal. She generates the midpoint at random, which means the points are uniformly distributed within the circle. Then the desired probability is the probability that the point lands in the circle of radius r over 2. This is a nice illustration of the transformation law for two variables. Instead of the Cartesian coordinates x and y, we use spherical coordinates r and phi. The transformation law yields for the correctly normalized PDF the following expression. The desired result requires that lowercase r is less than half the radius, and the corresponding probability gives 1/4. Finally, Laplace suggested to generate the radial distance uniformly between 0 and r, resulting in a constant PDF. In that case, the probability is 1/2. The question is now, which algorithm describes the physical experiment? This question is already on the mind of scientists for generations and still is. We can phrase the problem more generally. If we know nothing about the PDF apart from the definition of the setup, so there are no experimental data or additional theoretical constraints, what is the correct way to find an uninformative prior? So how to assign probabilities in the continuous way? Such an object is also called an ignorant prior. For ignorant priors, Ed Janes came up with the following idea. If there is a continuous and invertible map T of X from one set of variables X to a new set Y, then the corresponding PDFs should be the same. In the case of the die, it means that putting the pips on different sides of the cube should not modify the probability mass function. In other words, the probability mass function should be invariant against permuting the indices, which results in the well-known uniform distribution. Since the mapping in the continuous case is assumed to be continuous as well, we can introduce a parameter epsilon such that for epsilon going to 0, the mapping is the identity. Using the transformation law from above and the invariance properties of the PDF, Janes came up with the following equation for the PDF. Let's illustrate this approach for a scale variable. A scale variable X is a non-negative quantity for which the PDF should be scale invariant. In this case, the infinitesimal transformation has the following form. Janes' equation can be solved by elementary tools, and the result is P of X is equal to 1 over X. Note that this is a so-called improper PDF, as it cannot be normalized. In the frame of Bayesian probability theory, such a prior is not forbidden as long as the resulting posterior is normalizable. This scale invariant PDF is often called Jeffrey's prior, although it is only a special application of Jeffrey's idea. The uninformative prior PDF of parameters A depends, of course, on the meaning of the parameters. In many cases, these are uniquely determined by the likelihood function. In that case, a PDF that is invariant against reparameterization is given by P of A is equal to the determinant of G. A typical example of the scale variable is the standard deviation sigma that enters a Gaussian likelihood. This is a nice and informative exercise for the application of Jeffrey's prior. The result is the same as that obtained by Janes' approach. P of sigma is 1 over sigma. Ed Janes applied the principle of transformation invariance to the Bertrand paradox. He used the following transformations under which the problem is invariant. Translation of the center of the circle, rescaling of the radius, and rotation of the circle about the center. The solution of his equation yields the same result that Laplace proposed. P of r is constant. There is another way to approach the Bertrand paradox. Since the lines are drawn randomly and without knowing the position of the circle, we can equally well draw the line first and then randomly place the circle on the plane. The circle is uniquely defined by its center, and therefore this is equivalent to randomly choosing the coordinates x and y of the center. If we define the direction of the line as the x-axis, then the x-coordinate of the center is irrelevant. Consequently, the distance of the line from the center of the circle is given by the absolute value of y. As the coordinates of the center are chosen at random, the distance is a uniform random variable, corroborating Janes' result. We have encountered the maximum entropy principle already in the discrete case. It was introduced to obtain the probability mass function in the case of testable information, given, for instance, in the form of mean values. Maximum entropy can also be invoked for PDFs given testable information, for instance, in the following form. The only complication in the continuous case is that the entropy is not entirely what you would expect. The function P0 of x is sometimes called the default model, because the maximum entropy solution without any constraints apart from normalization yields P of x is equal to P0 of x. The deeper reason why we have a default model in the continuous case and not in the discrete case is that the transition by discretization from the continuous to the discrete case is not unique. The default model plays the role of an ignorant prior. Otherwise, the implementation of testable information in the maximum entropy procedure is the same as in the discrete case. On passing, we want to discuss a simple application from statistical physics. We want to infer the PDF P of x of particles at the height x above the Earth. The mean potential energy of these particles is proportional to the mean height. In a canonical ensemble, the mean energy is given by kBT, so the constraint has the following form. Maximizing the entropy yields the barometric formula. Note that x is not a scale variable here, as there is an upper limit for it. Therefore, a uniform prior is adequate, which is corroborated by the experimental observation for free particles without potential energy. In closing, it should be mentioned that this form of entropy is also called cross-entropy, or in other contexts, the Kullback-Leibler distance. It can be considered as distance between distributions, P of x and P0 of x, and it plays an important role in machine learning. The lighthouse problem that Lyra addressed in The Adventure is another example of the transformation of coordinates. Let x0 and y0 be the coordinates of the lighthouse and let the coastline define the x-axis, with the origin of the coordinate system being on the coastline. The lighthouse emits light signals that are uniformly distributed in the rotation angle phi about the lighthouse axis. We are interested in the PDF for a light signal being detected at point x on the coastline. The following relation exists between the coastline position x and the angle phi. The transformation law yields the desired PDF for x from the uniform PDF for the angle. This is the probability to find a light signal at position x, given the parameters x0, y0, and therefore it represents the likelihood of the problem. We assume for simplicity that the data points x sub I are uncorrelated. Bayes' theorem then yields for the desired PDF for the position of the lighthouse the following form. The prior probability depends on our knowledge about lighthouses. In the Pluto notebook, you can gain experience with this problem and see that it is indeed possible to locate the lighthouse on the basis of the distribution of the light flashes on the coastline. There are many important distributions for continuous variables. Here we only want to mention the most popular ones. We have repeatedly used Bayes' theorem to compute the posterior PDF for a parameter A given some data d. Let's first ignore the prior, then the posterior is proportional to the likelihood. In case of a counting experiment with a Poisson likelihood, the parameter A corresponds to the mean mu, and the data are the counts n. Then the posterior is of the following form. This function is a gamma distribution that is defined for the range x from 0 to infinity, and with the correct normalization it reads. It has a power law dependence for small x and decays exponentially for large x. Mean and variance are given by the following expressions. They can easily be derived from the gamma function, which is part of the normalization. The gamma function has a very convenient recursion relation. And for integer argument, it is related to the factorial. Moreover, we want to mention that gamma of 1/2 is equal to square root of pi. Special cases of the gamma distribution are the chi-square distribution and the exponential distribution. So far, we have only discussed the likelihood which led to the gamma distribution. If we include an arbitrary prior, then the posterior will be different. For that reason, it is common practice to also use a gamma distribution for the prior. This is not a significant restriction, as prior knowledge is typically vague and the gamma distribution is very flexible and can cover a wide range of prior knowledge. Such a so-called conjugate prior has the advantage that the posterior is still a gamma distribution and mean and covariance can be computed analytically. Now we turn to a Bernoulli experiment with sample size n. Here the parameter a corresponds to the intrinsic probability q, and the data is the number n of occurrences of the outcome of interest. Then the posterior is of the following form. This function is a beta distribution, which has the range x from 0 to 1, and the normalized distribution reads: mean and variance can be determined by means of the beta function. It also enters the normalization of the beta distribution. In case of a Bernoulli experiment, the conjugate prior is therefore a beta distribution. Finally, we want to mention the Gaussian distribution, which we have already encountered several times. The Gaussian is of central importance for the description of experimental noise, and the range of the random variable in the one-dimensional case is the entire real axis. The normalized Gaussian has a mean and a variance which is given by the following expressions. See the Pluto notebook about popular distributions and study the possible shapes that emerge by varying the parameters. Lyra in The Adventure also mentioned a very interesting discovery that the leading digits of large numbers form a pattern no matter what is considered. Shells, bottles, colored stones. The leading numbers all behave the same, and they are not uniformly distributed. This is in contradiction to the principle of indifference. This phenomenon has to do with scale invariances. We have seen before that the PDF of scale invariant quantities x is given by Jeffrey's prior, p of x proportional to 1 over x. Put differently, the PDF for the log of x is uniform. If you recall the intervals on logarithmic axes, you may have noticed that the interval sizes decrease from 1 to 9. Let's consider numbers x between 1 and 9.9999. The leading digit 1 corresponds to the interval x from 1 to 2 excluded. Then the probability is proportional to the logarithm of 2 minus logarithm 1. In general, the probability that the leading digit has the value I is proportional to logarithm of I plus 1 minus logarithm I. With the correct normalization for all possible digits 1 up to 9, we have the probability that the leading digit is I is given by log 10 of I plus 1 minus log 10 of I. This distribution is depicted in the figure. The same result is obtained if the numbers are in the interval 10 up to 99.999 or 100 to 999.999 and so on. Actually, the same law holds true also for counting experiments when the numbers vary over many orders of magnitude. Also in this case, the probability mass function is uniform on a logarithmic scale, or log uniform, as it is sometimes called. You will find a Pluto notebook to perform random experiments with log uniform distributions. This concludes lesson 8. We have learned about continuous variables and how to assign prior probabilities using the principle of transformation invariance or the maximum entropy principle. We have discussed Bertrand's paradox and know now why Benford's law describes the leading digit of counting lists and measurement tables. Check out the interactive Pluto notebooks to solve the lighthouse problem, to do your own Benford computer experiments, and to experiment with various popular distributions. Feel free to ask questions in the forum and feel encouraged to test your knowledge in the quiz.